Hi everyone, my name is Dave Evans. I'm from the University of Queensland, and I'm going to be talking about estimating the importance of maternal genetic effects on offspring phenotypes with MGCTA or maternal GCTA. I would like to dedicate this presentation in memory of Lyndon Eaves. Many of you might know Lyndon as one of the grandfathers of behavior genetics. Unfortunately, he passed away a few weeks ago, but he was responsible for many of the ideas behind MGCTA and indeed was the first author on the manuscript from 2014 in behavior genetics. So in this session, we're going to be talking about, first of all, GCTA and G-REML. So GCTA is the software package and G-REML is the method. And this is kind of a more simple model than MGCTA, which we really need to understand before we take things a little bit further and more complicated into the MGCTA world. So I'm going to start off by talking about what G-REML is, describe how we define genetic relationship matrices or GRMs, and talk about the underlying variance components model that GCTA fits. Then we'll move on from there and we will talk about MGCTA. I will describe the model and then I will derive the expected variance and covariances under the model using path tracing rules. So what is G-REML? Well, G-REML is genetic restricted maximum likelihood. And that statistical method basically provides us with an estimate of the amount of phenotypic variance explained by genetic markers on a SNP microarray. So this quantity, when you put it over, express it as a proportion of the total phenotypic variance, that's known as the SNP heritability. So it's the SNP heritability is the proportion of phenotypic variance explained by genetic markers on a SNP microarray. It's how much genetic variance do those markers tag. And the G-REML methods typically use unrelated individuals. So whereas we might estimate heritability, narrow sense heritability, using twin studies and related individuals, for this purpose here, we're using unrelated individuals. And this whole sort of space was originally devised to investigate what was called the missing heritability conundrum in human genetics. And this is basically the observation that when we first started doing genome-wide association studies and identifying genetic variants that were associated with common disease, those genetic variants only explained a very small fraction of the overall phenotypic variance of these common traits and diseases, far less than the heritability that was estimated from twin and family studies. And so the question was, well, where is this missing heritability? Where is it hiding? And so GCTA software and the G-REML method were kind of invented to address that question. And spoiler alert, basically turns out that a lot of that missing heritability is actually in the form of variants of very small effect, too small to be seen at genome-wide levels of significance in GWAS studies, scattered across the genome. So, you know, looking at thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of these variants of small effect. And so you can read more about GCTA and G-REML approaches in a series of papers by Jan Yang, Peter Vischer, and colleagues dating from 2010. And I've listed a few of those on the right-hand side of the slide. So how does this all work? Well, one of the ways you can think about it is in terms of fitting a linear regression through a big scatter plot. So I want you to imagine that we've got a sample of N individuals. And what we're going to do is we are going to plot on one axis, the phenotypic similarity or dissimilarity between each pair of individuals in our sample. So that is on the Y axis here. So it's labeled as square of the Z score difference. So you're basically taking the Z score for individual one, the Z score for individual two on their phenotype, taking the difference and then squaring it. So the more phenotypically dissimilar this pair of individuals are, the higher their value. So that's the Y axis. On the X axis is going to be a measure of their genome-wide genetic similarity. So individuals who are more genetically similar are going to lie at the right-hand side of the scatter plot. So imagine you got a sample of N individuals and you're going to plot each N choose two pairwise combination of individuals on that scatter plot. You're going to plot their phenotypic similarity against their genetic similarity. And once we've done that, we're going to fit a regression line through those data points. And so you could imagine that if a trait's genetically influenced, then individuals who are more genetically similar should be more phenotypically similar, right? So in other words, individuals who are more genetically similar, kind of sitting down here in the scatter plot, they're also going to tend to be more phenotypically similar. Whereas pairs of individuals who are less genetically similar, so down this end here, they will tend to be more phenotypically different. And the slope of that regression line is actually proportional to the SNP heritability. Okay, so this is not what goes on under the hood with GCTA and G-REML, but it's a useful way of thinking about the data intuitively and where GCTA and G-REML is getting the information from to estimate that SNP heritability. The other thing that I will point out is that the variance on this x-axis here, the kind of the spread of values, is very, very narrow, right? So most pairs of individuals are going to be sitting round about zero with a tiny little bit of spread either side. So intuitively, that's why the G-REML method is not particularly powerful. It's because you don't sort of have much variation in your X variable in which to fit that line of best fit. So if you contrast that with what goes on in the classical twin design, so as we've heard about this week, this is where you're comparing the similarity between MZ twins with the similarity between DZ twins. So imagine we were to plot twin pairs on this scatter plot. It'd look something like this. So all the MZ twins would be sitting up here at one. So they would have a sort of genetic correlation, genetic similarity of one, whereas the DZ twins would sit at 0.5, because on average they share half their alleles identical by descent. And so you could do exactly the same exercise. You could fit a regression line here. And again, the slope of this regression would be related to your trait heritability, not the SNP heritability, but the narrow sense heritability. So that's all the additive genetic variance over the phenotypic variance. You'll notice also that the spread of values is much greater with the classical twin designs, like all the way from 1 over to 0.5. And so that gives you some intuition as to why classical twin design is much more powerful for estimating the narrow sense heritability. Whereas with the GCTA G-REML approach, you know, you've got this tiny spread of values all on centered around zero. There's another design out there that you might have come across, which uses ordinary sibling pairs, or you could use DZ twins as well, but usually ordinary sibling pairs to estimate narrow sense heritability. And it capitalizes on the fact that sibling pairs on average share 0.5 of their genome identical by descent, but there's variation around that 0.5. And so again, you would expect that individuals who share more alleles identical by descent should be more phenotypically similar, and less so for the individuals who share less of their genome identical by descent. And so it's exactly the same idea in principle. You're just fitting a regression line through those points, and the slope of that regression is related to your narrow sense heritability. Again, there's not much variation in terms of your values on your x-axis. So again, this is not the most powerful approach to estimate heritability. This is kind of what it would look like in the case of GCTA and G-REML, where we're using unrelated individuals. So again, very narrow range of X values, meaning we don't have much power. And the slope of that regression is actually going to be a lot flatter than in the previous two examples. And that's because we're estimating SNP heritability, not narrow sense heritability. Very important point. Okay, so the GCTA process for running the software is basically a two-step process in order to estimate your SNP heritability and variance components. In step number one, we estimate what's called the genetic relatedness matrix, or GRM, as it's sometimes referred to. And the idea here is that that genetic relationship matrix is going to contain the genetic similarity of all n choose to pairwise combination of individuals in our sample. When you're calculating this matrix, very important to exclude one from each pair of individuals who are greater than, as a rule of thumb, 2.5% identical by state. And the reason for this is we want to ensure that everybody is unrelated in our samples. And there's two reasons for that. The first is, if we include individuals who are genetically similar, so let's say we included monozygotic twins, those highly similar, genetically speaking, individuals are also very likely to share similar common environments as well. So if we have those individuals in our sample, then that's going to be confounding genetics with environment. And so our estimates of SNP heritability are going to be biased upwards by the common environment, and we don't want that. So that's one reason. The second reason is that individuals like MZ twins are going to act like outliers in our analysis and dominate the results. So if you think back to the scatter plot in previous slides, most individuals in our sample are going to be round zero for their X value with a little bit of spread either side. If we put MZ twins in there, they're going to be way over at one. And so we've got outlying points in our regression. And so that will, you know, massively influence our regression slope and therefore our estimate of SNP heritability, and in all likelihood should push estimates of the SNP heritability upwards towards estimates of the true narrow sense heritability. So in other words, the more related individuals that you put in your analysis, the more estimates of SNP heritability are inflated towards the narrow set's heritability. So that's step number one, estimating the genetic relationship matrix. Step number two is then to estimate variance components and SNP heritability using either REML, which is restricted maximum likelihood, or via FIML, which is full information maximum likelihood. REML is the approach that the GCTA software package uses. FIML is the approach that we're going to use in OpenMX. In large samples, there's virtually no difference between the two, so you don't have to worry about it. In the next series of slides, I'm going to talk about how we can estimate the genetic relationship matrix.